In 1975, the fantastically lightweight broadcast quality camera weighed 12 pounds. This is the camera head only. The backpack with the camera control unit was another 22 pounds. If you wanted to record video in the field, you needed a portable tape recorder.
The U-matic VO3800 weighs 31 pounds. So it is truly a portable device.
By the end of the 1970s, the equipment got smaller and lighter, but a camera and a recorder were still two separate units connected with a cable. No wonder that television news departments still use 16mm film cameras whenever portability or ruggedness was required, not to mention image quality. The difference between film with fine details and cleanly delineated colors and soft 3/4-inch video with horrendous color smearing was so noticeable that many European broadcasters, in particular the BBC, continued to use film for factual programs well into the 1980s. The cry for a film-style portable single-unit video camera was answered in 1981 with the development of a video recorder camera, VRC, which combined camera and recorder into one unit, getting rid of the umbilical cord between them, promised video quality better than 3/4-inch format, and recorded on readily available and inexpensive consumer-grade tape. Since the 1970s, RCA experimented with analog component recording, which allowed to do away with a color subcarrier. In 1981, RCA Broadcast Video Systems teamed up with Panasonic to produce a recording camera system for electronic news gathering applications. Each company developed their own camera head, but used the same recorder. The recorder used standard VHS cassettes with a mechanism adapted from VHS tape recorder. Panasonic called its complete system M-format, alluding to the tape lacing method used on VHS machines. The Panasonic camcorder was named Recam. The arrival of a combination color TV camera and recording unit had been predicted for some time as the next logical ENG development. It was generally assumed that the first such integrated camera recorders would not arrive until a solid-state pickup array was ready. Therefore, it came as a surprise at the 1981 NAB convention to see not just one or two, but four new combination camera recorders. The Sony unit, which did not have official name at that time but later was branded Betacam, was designed to use Betamax video cassettes as the recording medium. The CV1 camcorder, developed for the Japanese NTV broadcasting company, recorded on the 1/4-inch tape using the Funai compact video cassette format. Both RCA and Panasonic promised production units of their respective systems by the first quarter of 1982. The systems were complete and the two companies were ready to take orders. Sony, on the other hand, anticipated to start marketing its system in spring 1982. The two new half-inch formats were in no way similar to VHS or Betamax consumer products, and they were not compatible with each other. Both systems offered 20 minutes of recording time from standard T120 VHS cassette or L500 Betamax cassette. Unlike Panasonic and RCA, who chose YIQ color recording format that closely matched NTSC broadcast television standard, Sony chose YRYBY format, which was more international, so to speak, and better matched a recently adopted standard for digital component video. In 1982, Bosch joined the emerging markets of camcorders. Like the RCA, Panasonic and Sony units, it used component recording with expanded luminance signal and compressed color signal, and was also modular. Unlike those units, it used the CVC cassette with 1/4-inch tape. By 1982, Hitachi updated its single-piece SR1 camcorder, developed under a research contract to Nippon Television, to a full professional quality 1/4-inch unit, taking the analog component route with the luminance channel and a multiplexed IQ channel. The SR1 was smaller than Sony Betacam, so at one point Sony considered converting its consumer Betamovie single-piece camcorder into a professional one. This camcorder BVW2 was produced in limited quantities and handed to NHK, a Japanese broadcasting company. In the summer of 1982, Betacam was not a complete system yet. Recam Hawkeye, on the other hand, offered a complete set comprising camcorders, studio recorders, and editing consoles. The same year, Ampex joined RCA Panasonic Alliance with a rebadged Panasonic Recam system, christened ARC, Ampex Recorder Camera. In October 1982, WKBD-TV from Detroit purchased the RCA Hawkeye video recorder camera system, becoming the first station in the world fully equipped in the new half-inch broadcast format. Meanwhile, in the spring 1982, Sony started taking orders for its Betacam camcorder. The BVW1 had just one tube with lower resolution than the competitors, 400 lines compared to 650 lines, but it was well matched to the recorder, which was limited to 300 lines. By the end of 1982, Sony released a three-tube version of the Betacam camera head, BVP3. The complete camcorder was called BVW3 and still was lighter and cheaper than the RCA Panasonic offerings. In the same year, Thomson of France joined the Betacam camp. 1983 was the year of a fierce format war. Ikegami launched the Unicam camera that was capable of accepting both onboard VCR formats. Philips announced that it would adopt the Bosch quarter-inch lineplex recording format for a new ENG recording camera. Meanwhile, the Bosch quarter-cam KBF1, which was shown previous year in prototype, was demonstrated as a production item, priced at $42,000. In 1983, Mulberry Square Productions created a new children's show for CBS, Benji, Zax, and the Alien Prince. According to Mulberry Square, the show was the first network dramatic series to be shot entirely on location on half-inch videotape with an integrated recorder camera. That recorder camera was the Panasonic M format camcorder.
At last, Your Highness, planet Earth.
Capital Cities Television Productions used Sony's Betacam half-inch video format for a documentary on adult illiteracy. Christopher Jeans, the producer, felt that the 3-tube Betacam was a major advantage over the M format in quality. By the end of 1983, more than 1,000 Betacams were sold to key end users, and Sony declared that Betacam had become the worldwide de facto standard. In 1984, the Panasonic RCA Alliance shuttered as RCA bailed out. Next year, RCA closed its broadcast systems division altogether. Meanwhile, CBS purchased of over 11 million worth of Sony Betacam equipment, committing itself to the new ENG format. The European Broadcasting Union adopted Betacam as its ENG format as well. It became increasingly clear that Betacam had won the first round over the M format, so Panasonic rushed to redesign its system, and redesign it did. In 1985, Panasonic presented M2, billed as a transition format on the way to the all-digital video studio. It had luminous bandwidth of 4.5 MHz and chrominous bandwidth of 1.5 MHz. The YIQ format, embodied in M format, was replaced with a YRYBY system, similar to Betacam. The mechanism had been changed as well. The head drum was increased, and M-type tape lacing was replaced with an approach similar to Sony's U-load. Using metal particle tape, M2 promised to offer quality comparable to that of 1-inch systems. Here it is, new old stock, still in wrapper. Loaded with thinner tape, heavy metal coating, the technology that Fuji originally developed for 8mm consumer video format, and helped with slower tape speed, this cassette stores 20 minutes of video, as much as the large VHS cassette in the older M format. The large cassette was updated with metal tape as well and could store 90 minutes of video. Increasing recording time was important because broadcasters started using half-inch component video not only for ENG, but for producing longer running programs. This was made evident by a stunning announcement by NBC that they had made a 5-year, $50 million commitment to M2. NBC's official announcement at 1986 NAB convention said, M2 is to be employed by all of the company's operating divisions, NBC Television Network, NBC Television Stations, NBC News, NBC Sports, and NBC Operations and Technical Services, and will be used at all levels, from news gathering in the field to the 1988 Seoul Summer Olympics, to primetime entertainment shows and commercial spots on all of NBC TV. But not everything in Panasonic's garden was rosy. Ampex, who previously marketed Panasonic's Recam camcorder as Ampex ARC, defected from the Panasonic camp and signed a cross-licensing agreement with Sony. Another ally was Bosch, who dropped its Lineplex format and embraced Betacam. According to Sony, about 25,000 Betacam systems had already been sold worldwide, with about 6,000 sold in the United States. In 1987, Panasonic launched a smaller camcorder with a camera head having 3-chip CCD pickup with electronic shutter and the recorder using the pocket-sized M2 cassette. JVC started to offer its M2 equipment. Sony launched Betacam SP, an updated and compatible variant of Betacam. SP machines could record both on conventional ferric oxide tape as well as on new metal tape, similar to one used in M2 machines. Sony also introduced a large Betacam cassette that could fit 60 or even 90 minutes of video, matching M2. Ampex continued to re-establish itself in the camera market, manufacturing Beta SP equipment in the United States at the company's Colorado Springs facility. French Thomson CSF licensed Betacam SP technology from Sony. BTS, a joint Philips-Bosch company, launched its own line of Betacam equipment. By 1989, Betacam SP established itself as the world's most popular video acquisition format, supported by allies like Bosch, Philips, Thomson, and Ampex. By that time, Ampex has been in the Betacam business for over 3 years, building and testing Betacam SP portable and studio video recorders, cameras, camcorders, and accessories in its own Colorado Springs factory. BTS combined the recorder technology license from Sony with a camera side developed in-house. This single-piece camcorder, as well as its Sony sister models BVW 200, 300, and 400, used a new compact mechanism, while Panasonic went from M-type loading on the M-format machines to something similar to U-type loading on the M2, increasing the size of the head drum in the process. Sony switched from its traditional U-type loading to a more compact scheme that resembled M-type loading. The head drum size was reduced by 1/3, it was fitted with 4 heads instead of 2, and the wraparound angle was increased from 180 to 270 degrees. Additionally, the cassette would move 15 mm towards the drum during loading, with the cassette shell partially overlapping the drum. This allowed Sony to reduce camcorder size without developing a smaller cassette. Needless to say, this mechanism was fully compatible with existing Betacam and Betacam SP recordings. Betacam, especially in its SP variant, proved to be a versatile format capable to replace all 2-inch studio dinosaurs, 3/4-inch ENG porter packs, as well as 1-inch EFP machines. NBC remained committed to M2 for news and commercials. By 1991, M2 was employed by NHK in Japan, Thames TV in the United Kingdom, ORF in Austria and KBS in South Korea. Everyone else used Betacam. Component analog video became bridge technology, providing the pathway to higher quality digital recording and playback. But this is a topic for another video. Please like and subscribe. Goodbye.